Greetings, everyone. A very warm welcome to India's first WSO2 community meetup co-hosted by LTI and WSO2. My name is Nishant, and I'm on the business development team for LTI's Digital Integration Strategic Business Unit, and I'll be your moderator for this meetup. Today, we present to you a platform to sharpen your API development skills and grab first-hand knowledge about WSO2's open source API-led integration platform that features API management, enterprise integration, customer identity, and access management capabilities. Gain insights into LTI's journey with WSO2 and our strong alliance that has helped our customers modernize their integration landscape with ease. With that being said, I'd like to introduce you to today's presenters who bring immense experience in the field of enterprise integrations. We have Vidura Gamini Abeya, who is a senior director at WSO2. Vidura heads the Solution Architecture Group in the APAC region and provides technical guidance to customers in architecting solutions on the WSO2 platform. He is an experienced technologist and an executive with over 15 years of global experience in the software industry, covering many domains such as finance, logistics, aviation, and energy. He has led the technical advisory for open banking projects in the Europe and the UK regions as well, and has also worked in Australia and US. Narayan Nanjan, aka NN, is a delivery manager and the COE lead for the Digital Integration Strategic Business Unit, LTI. He is an experienced technologist with over 15 years of IT experience in enterprise integration and automation. He has led multiple functional and technical consulting engagements, and he has vast experience in the integration project management space, business, and competency development programs. Before I hand over the session to Vidura, I have a few housekeeping items to cover about this session and the GoToWebinar platform. By default, all the participants except the speakers are muted to minimize disturbance and ensure the session is run smoothly. We'll be answering questions at the end of the session. If you have a question for our speakers, please post your queries on the chat window. Rest assured that if you don't get your questions answered during today's session, we'll be sure to follow up afterward. And one more important announcement, attendees staying for the entire duration of this meetup will be getting pro codes to get certified on the WSO2 product stack free of cost. So without any further ado, I'd like to kick things off by welcoming Vidura Gamini Abeya. Vidura, over to you.
Thank you, Nishant. Good morning, everybody. So we are going to talk a little bit about the WSO2 open source developer friendly API led integration platform. So I'm going to switch off my camera and then let you concentrate on the slides. One more housekeeping announcement from me as well. While the presentation is going on, we are also running a poll as part of this presentation, and at the relevant times, there will be a slide that is shown to you saying it's poll time, and there will be a question that is posted to you that will appear on your screen. Please do provide us with the answers and the feedback that will help us to make this presentation much better and the future events also much better for you. So with that, let me start on the presentation. So let me first switch off my camera. Right. As you already know, I work with the solutions architecture team at WSO2. I've been with the company now for about 5 years. Before solutions architecture, I've been part of engineering at WSO2 as well. I've led multiple teams at WSO2, the engineering teams, and then I've been with solutions architecture now for about 3 years. I head the solutions architecture function in APAC, and I also work with a lot of customers around the globe, predominantly in Europe as well. So feel free to reach out to me if you have any questions or any other way that we can help you with in your journey with WSO2. So I want to start off with a little bit about the company for those of you who don't know WSO2 much. So we as a company help digitally driven organizations become integration agile. So we are the number one open source integration vendor in the world. We not only are our products open source, we also use quite a lot of open source libraries and other technologies within our products. So as part of that, we also contribute quite a lot to the open source community. Whenever we have, we do enhancements, we do bug fixes and so on. So we do actively participate and contribute to these upstream projects. So as a result, we are also the sixth largest Apache committer in the world. And we are also the sixth largest open source vendor, irrespective of what you know, what business line or line of software you are in. So a few stats for you to understand, you know, our contribution to open source and how we use open source. A bit about the company. So we have a 15-year-old company now, and we've got about 600 plus employees working around the globe. 50% of this, the number is in engineering. As you already know, our products are open source. And we have officers around the globe, as I said, a whole bunch of officers that covers pretty much all the different time zones in the world. And we've strategically placed some of those officers to make sure that we are available to our customers 24/7, 365. And we are not only limited to what you see on the screen, we are in the process of opening up new officers in other locations as well. So right now we have more than 550 customers around the world, and by customers we mean people, organizations who use our products as well as still pay for support and services to us. If you take the number of users of WC2 projects products, that could be in the thousands or even more. So in 2019 alone we added 129 new logos. Like I said, we are 15 years old, so we were founded in 2005, and we are backed by some venture capitalists, Cisco and Toba Capital. And as a company, we've seen very steady growth, 20% year-on-year growth at least in the past few years. So WSO2 has an integration platform. The integration platform basically has is on three product pillars. Those three products are open source, as you know. We have the WSO2 API manager, which handles all the API lifecycle management operations, and then the whole discipline of API management. We have a integration product suite called the WSO2 Enterprise Integrator that basically can connect anything to anything. And then we have a customer identity and access management solution, which is called the WSO2 Identity Server. So all these three products have a common architecture and a common code base. These three products are also not only available for you to download from our website and use as on-premise products. We also provide these products on the cloud as well, as public cloud offerings, as well as private cloud offerings. So the difference between the two being the public cloud will be a shared deployment between multiple tenants with complete isolation. And if it is a private cloud option, that means it's a dedicated deployment for you that is managed by WSO2 DevOps team. So we have not only limited our work to these three products act as the three pillars that hold up our integration platform. What we've done is we've also gone and built certain solutions using certain capabilities of these products, and then also added a few additional things that are required for these solutions. So one couple of examples are the WSO2 Open Banking solution, which caters to PSD2 in Europe as well as the CDR, the Consumer Data Rights Movement in Australia. And we are adding more and more specifications to this. This takes care of all the different aspects that have to do with regulated open banking. Then we also have a healthcare integration product that enables interoperability between different platforms using FHIR standards and things like that. And we are in the process of building more and more solutions like this. So like I said, the three pillars are the three products, and then we have a bunch of solutions that are built on top of it. But also for to help our customers, our users, we also have two supporting aspects. We have the WSO2 methodology for agility and the WSO2 architecture for agility. If you remember, I mentioned that our mission is to help organizations become integration agile. So the technology component is covered by the products, but when you want to become an agile enterprise, especially in the integration, you know, with the integrations that you do, you will need obviously other help from different aspects, such as you know, how do you actually approach such a project. So WSO2 has a methodology or a five-stage maturity model to identify where an organization is, and then allow you know, or advise organizations how to move to where they want to be in this integration agile maturity model. And then we also support that model with a five-stage architectural transformation approach. Once again, you can, as an organization, you can identify where you are, and then where you want to be, we will help you to get there. Then all of our products also support cloud native integration. So we support containerized deployments, container management technologies such as Kubernetes. And then we've also built a whole bunch of other technologies around it that makes this possible. Ballerina, for example, is an open source programming language that is targeted towards integration and microservices. I'm not covering Ballerina on this talk because it actually requires another talk on its own, so we will maybe do one on that in the future, one of the future meetups. So like I said, the products are available to you know, to you in hybrid deployment mode, where you can run certain things on premise, certain things on the cloud, or as a combination. So our products have also seen a good range of accolades from the industry, as well as you know, from different consultancy companies and things like that. This is the latest Forrester Wave that was published very recently in Q3 2020. As you can see, WSO2 is positioned there as a leader in the API management space, along with IBM, Google, and Software AG. We are kind of the only for open source company that is there in that space. So this is a quite a big achievement for us. We were featured in this before as well, but we have further strengthened our capabilities in the API management space, and they have recognized it in that way by this positioning. Similarly, in the integration space also, Gartner has rated us, saying that we the customers, 40% of the customers looking for a complete open source integration solution prefer WSO2. So this is something that Gartner featured as well. And similarly, our customer identity and access management solution has been featured in Kuppinger Kohl in the analysis that they did, as again an overall leader in this space as well. So like that, all of our products have received such accolades from different analysts. A bit about our customers. So we have customers around the globe. As you can see, we have customers in every inhabited continent. This is expanding with the new logos we add every quarter. We cover more and more countries that we didn't have a presence before. A major part of our business is international, although we have a big presence in Europe and North America. We've been steadily growing our business in other parts of the world as well. Some of our flagship customer examples can be seen here in different industry verticals. You may have experience, or you may be customers of some of these logos. Every time you buy something on eBay, that goes through hundreds of our enterprise integrator instances that they have. So likewise, you may be indirectly using our products when you use or do business with any of these customers. So we also take pride in our technology, and we believe our technology is very easy to adapt. Our mantra is basically to keep our products open source, and you can, as a developer, you can always download the source code of our products from GitHub, and then there are so many things that we do in developing these products as well as to foster the community as an organization that appeals to developers. So as a developer, you can easily see how our products work by downloading the source code and having a look at it, and the source code that is available on GitHub is the complete product. We don't have two versions that is partially, that's open source as well as commercial. We have just one version of the product. What you download from the GitHub is basically the source code that runs in every, the real product. And then everything that we work on, including the features, the documentation, everything are on GitHub. If you go to the relevant GitHub pages, you will see everything tracked using issues and projects within GitHub. So you have complete visibility on how our products are developed, what features are released in the future releases and things like that. And there are many ways as a developer you can contribute to our products as well. You can contribute to products by sending, if you want to make a change or enhancement or anything like that, you can, just contribute by sending a pull request to us. You can maybe suggest certain changes or additions or anything like that into the documentation by a similar way. We have public mailing lists where we discuss design and architecture related things about the products, which are open to everybody. So once these slides are shared with you, you can click these relevant links and see the pages that allow you to see how to subscribe to these links and things like that. So basically, we have architecture at wc2.org and dev at wc2.org, two mailing lists that are open for everybody. And there's a few more as well that sends builder announcements and things like that. So you're free to join them if you are interested in knowing how we develop our products and what goes into them. We internally, we follow a strict protocol where all the decisions that we make about a product are posted to the group so that the wide audience outside of WSO2 can also comment and contribute. We have a lot of training material on the web, free self-paced training, certification options for developers, product admins, and architects. We do a whole bunch of public webinars and then meetups like this. We have our own YouTube channel that you can use. You can also use to gain your knowledge about WSO2 products. And then we have a bunch of things that we do for the community. Each product has a community call. We have Slack channels that you can ask any questions through that are manned by the actual developers who work on these products. We have a very active community on Stack Overflow if you want to ask questions. And then we organize a bunch of events, like I said before. So there's a whole bunch of things if you're a developer who's interested in our technology, who can actually contribute and get to know about products. Right. So we've reached the first poll right now. So I think you will get the first question on your screens in a couple of seconds. And after that, if you can provide us with the answers, we can go ahead with the rest of the presentation after that. Right. Okay. Thank you for that. So here on, what I'm going to do is I'm going to go into each of the technology pillars, starting off with API Manager. And then, so each of these products actually warrant a separate meetup session to go through the cool features that we have in the products. But what I'm going to do is I'm going to give you a very high level overview of what they have, what they look like, and what they have, and also highlight some of the developer related features that we have in our products for you to use. So let's get started with WSO2 API Manager. Right. So WSO2 API Manager is an open source complete API management platform that is cloud native, hybrid, and platform agnostic. So this suits both traditional API management as well as microservices based deployments as well. As you can see, the API manager has different, a management plane and a data plane and a control plane. Inside each of these different planes, you have these orange colored boxes that are actually different profiles or different components of the API manager. So these, so the gateway, the key manager, the traffic manager, the API publisher, the developer portal, and the analytics. So these are the primary components of the API manager. Other than analytics, the rest of them can be run within the same Java virtual machine, or so that is our basic deployment where we call you run it in like a all-in-one mode, as you expose your deployment further to increasing traffic, you can partially or fully distribute your deployment. So the first two usually scale in this are the gateways, and then the key manager, the traffic manager, and so on. And you have the flexibility to use different deployment patterns based on that, so if you go to our documentation, it has ample information about how the different deployment patterns as well as what suits what scenario. So we also have certain support for Kubernetes and Istio service mesh and things like that, which you will see on the subsequent slides. So basically the data plane, like we call it, are the gateways. The management plane is basically the two portals that we have, the publisher and the developer portal. These two can be actually used to create an API marketplace. This has things like features like integration with billing engines and so on, which I will cover later. And then you have the control plane. We have a key manager component that acts as an STS or a secure token service. We have a traffic manager component that does with all the throttling and rate limiting and things like that. And then we have the analytics module that can give you business insights as well as certain anomaly detection and notifications and alerts and things like that. So some of the core competencies that we have in the product are shown on this slide, but not limited to. So on the gateway, you have policy enablement, protocol handling. You can do the different transformations to the payloads that you get. Then we have this concept of a micro gateway that I will talk about also, which is more suited for cloud native containerized deployments. Then we have we support a lot of security protocols, or to OpenID Connect, federated identity. You can use our identity server in place of the key manager to get certain things, additional capabilities in this space as well. But the key manager on its own can handle OIDC, SAML2, and things like that as well. Then we support self-contained JWT tokens, API keys, and then we also have AI-driven API security, along with a collaboration of Ping Intelligence, which we integrate with that additional module from them to give you AI-based security aspects as well. Then in the analytics, you get to know how your APIs are used, whether there's real-time alerting, traffic management, and then the monetization options, the analytics engine that collects all the usage data that goes into the billing engine eventually. And then we have cloud-native features such as Istio integration. We support deployments on Kubernetes, Docker, PCF, and a few other deployment platforms also. We support monitoring with the Elk Stack, Prometheus, Grafana, and things like that. And we have published documentation on how you can implement your own CI/CD pipelines, whether you're using containers, whether you're using VMs, and so on. So all that is available on the public documentation on docs.wsu.com. And then we have the portal and the store that can be used to implement a marketplace, do monetization hooks to billing engines and things like that. And then you can team them as you wish, and so on. So there's a whole bunch of features that go into, you know, in each of these that you get in each of these components. So we'll briefly look at each one of them. So as an API runtime, we have multiple gateway options. We have the micro gateway that is more suitable for immutable container native type of deployments. We have a regular gateway that is robust, and you know, it has been used in the industry for a long time, and it's completely API driven and ideal for, you know, things like brownfield projects. If you might have the micro gateway, is slightly different because it you can basically easily containerize it, because it like when you generate the micro gateway, what you do is you bake in the API artifacts into the micro gateway and then create a container that you can easily run as an instance on something like Kubernetes. And both of these gateway options use the same management plane. Both can be used in the same deployment. Some of our customers use this in a so let's say, for example, certain type of gateways in the DMZ, certain type of like micro gateway in the DMZ, and the regular gateway for internal API management, things like that. And so you have the hybrid option also. Like I said, you can have the management plane on the cloud. You can have the gateways deployed closer to your backend services. And these gateways can actually scale with or without the management plane, depending on the type of tokens and security measures you use. We support self-contained JWT tokens that allows the gateways to you know, do the token validation on itself without going to the key manager, you know, doing frequent trips to the key manager. So because of that, you can easily scale the gateways without the requirement of scaling the other components. And then gateways are identity provider agnostic as well. They can actually work with any third-party key manager as well, as long as there's a trust is established and a signed token is used. So we have you have that flexibility also to use something that you may already have. So like I said, the standard gateways support SOAP and WebSocket based APIs in addition to REST, and then also there's automatic SOAP to REST conversion on this. There is a config driven mediation support on these gateways where you can, you know, do protocol transformation and things like that as you wish. The micro gateway is more designed to scale, and it has a smaller footprint than the regular gateway. It can run in like more like a you know, in an environment like a lockdown environment, like a DMZ, for example, because it's stateless, it's immutable. It can collect stats off like offline and then submit everything to the analytics engine in a batch mode. It can do localized rate limiting, so it doesn't have to talk to the traffic manager all the time, and so on. So there are multiple features here that allows the micro gateway to be more suited for containerized deployments, and as it has native support for Docker, Kubernetes, and things like that as well. Then the API publisher is the portal that is used by API designers and product managers. Here you have features to design, mock, and document REST and SOAP APIs. You can do version management on the APIs. You can also gain certain insights on the API usage. You can import API definitions to this. This is where you also apply certain policies like security, rate limiting, and message transformation and things like that. The product comes with certain message transformation, like common policies, common use cases, all out of the box, like JSON to XML, XML to JSON, and things like that. And then you can use something like that that's already there, or you can write your own message transformation logic and deploy it here as well. So as if you're a product manager, then you can validate and publish APIs here for public discovery and consumption. This is where you would also manage the whole lifecycle of the API. You can monetize the API through business plans. And then we also have this the new feature called API product. It has been there for the last two releases now, since the last two releases, which I will touch on a separate slide. right? And then once again, you can also gain API usage insights here. So the publisher, you can start off with an existing endpoint or a contract and design the design of, you can either create a production level API or prototype a new API. So what we do here is we have support for API first development. What we mean by API first development is you don't really think about the API after you develop the backend service. Rather, you do the API first. You don't have to wait until the backend service is ready for you to work on the API, and you have the ability with API WSO2 API Manager to first create the API, mock it, and even let your potential users use it, give you feedback while another team might be working on the backend service that actually is fronted by that API, right? So there are features like that which I will cover in the subsequent slides, and then you can expose SOAP services. You can convert it to REST as or as just pass through the SOAP messages as it is. You can actually use GraphQL here as well. You can expose an API with GraphQL support. We also support streaming APIs through WebSocket endpoints. So for API product managers, we have some productization features as well as monetization features here. You may have multiple APIs that you have internally or available publicly. As a product manager, what you can do is you can combine certain operations from different APIs, bundle it together, and then publish it as a new product or a new API. And then this gives you the flexibility of using only certain operations from different APIs and bundle them together and publish it as a separate API. So with this feature, you can create sellable products and then monetize some of these APIs. The parent API that you got the operations from may not be monetized, but you have the freedom to monetize the newly created API product. So you can monetize them targeting different groups as a result. So like I said, you can expose GraphQL services as managed APIs here. So we support authentication, operational level authorization, rate limiting, and all of that for these GraphQL APIs. And we also, even for queries, mutations, and all of that you can do with GraphQL. So if you're a developer, you can also write your GraphQL queries, and then there is an embedded GraphQL tryout feature where you can do everything on the API manager itself. And you can see the potential payloads that you get if somebody calls this the APIs. And all of that that can be done on the WSO2 API Manager publisher itself. Then we also have AWS Lambda support. So if you can have a Lambda function being exposed as a managed API, and then all you have to do is it's a pretty simple thing. You just have to provide your AWS credentials here, and then select the right resource level ARNs here, and then you can expose it as an API, and then you can apply the same type of policies that you would do for any other API onto these APIs as well. So that gives you a lot of flexibility on how you want to, what type of backends you want to use. So you might see on this where there's HTTP REST endpoints, SOAP endpoints like that. We have also support for dynamic endpoints here, and then prototype endpoints I will cover in the later slides, and of course the Lambda functions like we just discussed, right? So moving on. So if you're an API developer, we let you, so if you create an API within the API publisher, you can either use the wizard or you can directly work on the Swagger. So if you are an experienced developer who would like to work on the Swagger file directly, what you can do is you can go to the Swagger view and update that. And then that will basically, you can always switch between the two. And the changes that you do on one side will always be visible on the other side. So we support all of that so that you can use Swagger if you want to in the publisher. But if you want to use your favorite editor and then do the Swagger, implement the API, and then create the Swagger file, we have an option for that too, which I will cover in the later slides. Right. So like I said, APIs can be prototyped using mock backends. So what you can do is the behavior of the API, of a prototype API, can be scripted using the available JavaScript interface on the API publisher itself. So what you see on the screen on the right hand side is this place where you would go and script this. So it allows you to define different payloads for different HTTP status codes, access message properties, and access message properties, and then do, like, you can return different payloads based on different conditions, as you know, so that it's a lot more dynamic, even though it's a prototyped API. So alternatively, what you can do is you can have the prototype API pointed at a prototyped endpoint also, which can be a mock service, like a microservice, that also has some logic. So you have both options of either scripting it on the publisher or having an external endpoint act as the mock endpoint, right? And then with managed APIs, APIs can be sandboxed for anybody who's still building the application. So let's say an API consumer who's building the applications using your API, you may not want to give them direct access to the production. What will eventually happen is you can give them first access to the sandbox and then upgrade them to production once they've completed everything, the testing and everything, right? So that option is also there. Then API lifecycle management is also available on the publisher. You can manage stages of the API. So basically, as a developer, you can use the states to manage the life of an API. APIs can be versioned, and then that allows you to gracefully retire, for example, old versions or old APIs. For example, you might see that there is a deprecated state on this lifecycle. If you make an API deprecated, that means no new consumers can subscribe to it, but the existing subscribers can keep on using it until you retire it, right? So things like that we support. You can basically audit the lifecycle changes as well, and we do support custom lifecycles so the API manager comes with a lifecycle that you see on the screen out of the box. But the lifecycle stages and the transitions can be customized as you wish, and extended as well. And then you can also trigger certain extensions based on the lifecycle state changes as well. Like, for example, if you want to publish your API to an external portal or something like that, you can configure that using a transition between, so going from, say, a prototype to published or created to published. So like that, you can customize it the way you want, right? And then we have the developer portal. This is the portal that the API consumers use to discover your APIs, to read documentation about your APIs, and then also subscribe to your APIs. Then then you also gives them the option of searching through the documentation, allows them to comment, rate. There are discussion forums internally also, it also allows you to there are multiple languages supported through different SDKs that allows developers to quickly create the stubs that are required to call your API in the preferred language of their choice, this is where you would also subscribe to the APIs. And then also, this is a place, if you have monetized APIs, you can see your invoices and things like that as well, right? So the developer portal along with the publisher, both of them use actually, they are all built on React.js. Because React.js is a very popular, very popular framework, you can easily use your existing skills to theme and customize the UIs as you wish. So like I said, we have support for billing system integration as well out of the box. We integrate directly with Stripe. You can attach business plans to an API when you create an API on the publisher. And what happens eventually is when the consumers start using your API, the analytics module tracks their usage and submits that data to the billing engine. And then once they are billed, the API consumer can view their invoices through the developer portal. Now, although we support our Stripe out of the box, you have if you have other billing engines that you want to integrate with, you can easily do so because there are extension points and we have documentation on how to use those extension points. And then we also support multiple pricing models such as fixed price or pay as you go. We also have a lot of tools that you can use as a developer to do some of these operations on the command line. One such example is the API controller tool that you can use, for example, in a CI/CD pipeline. So this API control tool, you can use to create API projects, which is completely file system based. And you can import APIs to the management plane using this tool. You can export APIs from the management plane to the disk using this tool. This allows you to move an API from a, let's say, for example, a low environment to the higher environments, right? And this tool can easily be used for scripting a CI/CD pipeline. So for example, you having the API artifacts on the disk allows you to easily keep them on version control systems of your choice, like GitHub or anything like that. And then you can also easily fetch that and use that from any of the CI/CD servers that are very popular, like for example Jenkins or Travis. And then you can use the API control tool from them to push the APIs into the different environments and then run the whole CI/CD process. So we'll look at a little bit about how you can do that in the next few slides. Now, one example I can give you, let's say as a developer, you use, like I said before, you can use your favorite IDE to implement the Swagger, that is, or implement the API definition, let's say using Swagger. And all you have to do is once you've done that, you use the API control tool like you see on the slide here to initialize a project, and you just point it at the YAML file that you just created, right? And what it does is it creates a folder called the Petstore API project that has a folder structure where you have a place for the Swagger and then you have a place for the mediations and things like that. And then once you fill that with whatever you wish to have on that API, what you do thereafter is basically use that same tool and say import API, like you see on the third step here, and you can give a environment variable like this as to say whether it's a development environment, test environment, production, and so on. So this will be driven by another file, which I will show you in the next slide. So basically this API control tool now will import this API that is available. It will read the Swagger file in this folder and then import that API into the publisher with just a single command. So what happens is it also deploys that API in the gateway. So if you have a QA person or the developer themselves can do all the testing on the API manager. And once you're done with the testing, now you can export that API. Once again, you can version it. And then you can export that into once again a folder structure and then import that into the next environment as you wish. So like that, you can use the same tool to promote an API from the lower environment to the higher environment. Now, if you automate this process, it will look something like this, where the developer first implements the API specification, writes some tests, maybe using Postman, let's say, for example, and then initialize the project. And you have the folder structure for that. And then what you do is you commit that to, let's say, GitHub, along with this file called the environment parameters file, that where you have the different environment-based parameters that you identify by this dev or prod or whatever label. So if you have something like Jenkins configured to look at the GitHub project, where whenever there is a change in the GitHub project, it can trigger a build. And that build can, you know, the Jenkins can push that API to the development environment, and then the Postman scripts can be run, the tests can be run here. And once the tests and all of that are run, so basically the API control tool pushes that API to the gateway in the development environment, also to the publisher, all of that is done. And using this import API command, you run the tests on the gateway, right, on the API. And then once everything passes, what you can do is you can either export it and import it to the production, or since it's the same API that didn't change, you can import that API into the production now directly from Jenkins. So like that, you can configure this to go through multiple stages of a pipeline as you wish. Right, and then we have a similar support if you're using containerized deployments. We have similar support on Kubernetes. Basically, what we have is we have created a Kubernetes operator, which you can download from Operator Hub, for example. That once you have that installed, Kubernetes will start treating APIs as first class citizens within Kubernetes. So, for example, you can now say kub control add and give API as, so it'll understand what an API is thereafter, and then you just have to point it at the Swagger definition. What this does is, the moment you execute this command, it basically deploys this API in a micro gateway instance and then spawns the pod and starts running it, right? So with a single command, it does everything. So you can actually apply policies automatically, like security throttling policies and logging and things like that. You can also enable analytics and all that, because all of that is contained within the Swagger through extensions, and you can make that Swagger format self-contained. So once you have it deployed on the gateway, you can run your tests like what we discussed earlier, and then get it going. But at the same time, you can also use the control tool to import the API to the management plane, right? So the publisher. So it can just basically import that API into the publisher. So with just two commands, you have a single command to get the API up and running, and then additional command to import it to the management plane. So like that, with just a couple of commands, you can get the API, your API, from a Swagger file to a running instance and the published on the management plane. So behind the scenes, how this happens, in fact, is the Kubernetes operator that we have basically does two things. One is it runs the moment you say kub control, add the API, the operator simply runs Kaniko, which is actually building the Docker image and pushing that Docker image to the registry. So it builds the Docker image using the base micro gateway base image that is there on the available on the Docker registry, or Docker Hub or private Docker repository you can point to, right? And then that is pushed to the Docker registry, and at the same time, once that Docker image is built, it deploys an instance of container as a container here, and then registers everything. So it basically deploys the instance of a newly built Docker image as a Kubernetes pod, and then registers with the necessary Kubernetes services as well. So all of that happens for you behind the scenes using just a single command. So if you are a microservices developer who has microservices deployed on Kubernetes, basically you may have a scenario that is similar to this, you expose your microservices directly to the consumers with not so much policies being applied there, and maybe not no access control or whatever, not much at least rate limiting or whatever. So, but with the API operator, what you can do is with a single command, you can, or if you use both the commands, you can actually get a gateway, a management, a proper managed API layer fronting your microservices. And it doesn't have to be a single gateway. You can have multiple gateways. And so the micro gateway can even run like a sidecar or a private jet for each microservice. So you can choose the way that you want to deploy it. But you get a managed API layer that has security, rate limiting, monitoring, and all those policies applied. which is also backed by a control plane and a management plane, where you can get additional insights and have more control over how your microservices are used. So the analytics component, I've mentioned about it here and there. Basically, it collects all the runtime operation events and things like that, and the gateways actually publish events to the analytics component in an asynchronous mode, so that it doesn't impact the performance of the API consumer or the gateways. So you can use the analytics component to so we have our own dashboards in the analytics component that allows you to see the different insights on the of the API usage and things like that, but it also can give you alerts and notifications on abnormal usage patterns that you can, you know, you can then later act upon, right? And then the analytics can be integrated with external monitoring tools. So we actually have created, other than our own analytics, we have created out of the box integrations with the Elk stack, as well as Jaeger, Prometheus, Grafana as well. And then, you know, this does near real-time calculations. And also this analytics is what helps in also a bit of the rate limiting aspects as well here. Right. So those are the features and the developer centric features that we have on API Manager. Now, before we move on to the next section, we have another poll. So you'll see the poll questions coming up on your screen in a few seconds. Right. So let's move on. Before we move on to Enterprise Integrator, I'll quickly answer a question that is there. So there is a question about asking me to repeat the deployments on cloud and support from WSO2. So basically, the same products that I'm showcasing right now are available for you to download, as well as the same products are available to use download, as well as available on the cloud. We have a hosted solution for you, and then you have also the private cloud option, where you can have a dedicated deployment hosted by us for you. The public cloud option is basically a shared deployment. Right? I hope I answered the question. If you have further questions, do post it and I'll try to answer at the end. Right. So let's quickly move on to Enterprise Integrator. So this is an open source, once again, a cloud native distributed hybrid integration platform for integrating APIs, data, and event streams using microservices, cloud native, and or centralized ESB style architectures. Now, what do we mean by that? So basically, we support conventional ESB style integrations, where you might have a central integration platform. The Enterprise Integrator can be deployed in such an architecture, where it acts as the central integration platform, as well as if you are doing microservices, you might have heard of this concept called smart endpoints and downpipes, right? Smart endpoints in a microservice architecture has the ability to either talk to or route the messages intelligently to another endpoint, or talk to multiple other endpoints, construct a message, and then send it back, right? So the Enterprise Integrator has two different components, the ESB style integrator, as well as a component called micro integrator. The micro integrator can be used in a microservices architecture to build these smart endpoints. If you are looking for a traditional centralized integration platform, we have the ESB type of capabilities with Enterprise Integrator as well. Then we have data integration services, as well as business processes, process support. Also, we have a message broker product, which we are now going to replace with RabbitMQ in the future, support for RabbitMQ. And then we have integration analytics and tooling, which I will cover in the next few slides. So in terms of the open interoperability standards that we have, So we support a whole bunch of different standards, whole bunch of different transport protocols, message formats, authentication protocols, and things like that. So you can use all of these type of you know, these standards with the enterprise integrated product in some form or the other. What this product essentially does is it connects anything to anything. So it does it by doing multiple things. So on your right, you will see a whole bunch of systems, business applications, partner systems, APIs, and things like that. So all of these systems may have some sort of interface that allows you to connect to, you know, that allows connecting to it, like a SOAP interface or a REST interface or anything like that. So the enterprise integrator can make use of some of these to tap into those, integrate with those systems. But you might have certain systems like, let's say you might have scenarios where you want to connect to like message brokers or things like that. So in those cases, we support things like JMS and then file system, right? So for example, the file system could be where you listen to file changes to file systems and things like that as well, right? So in addition to this, you might also have a scenario where you want to connect to any legacy systems. And the legacy system does not have any interface to outside. So basically, the interface to outside, like if you don't have, you can go to the data layer and then expose data as services with our product, right? And then if you have things like cloud services that you want to connect to, like Salesforce, SAP, Workday, and things like that, we have a separate connector framework that allows you to use the connectors to connect to this. I will talk about connectors in a little bit, but basically you have a whole bunch of connectors that you can readily use to connect to some of these systems. So the enterprise service bus functionality that we have, like I said, can do, you know, it can work with known standards, domain specific certain protocols and things like that. So it supports integration with these proprietary systems through connections, through connectors. It's completely configuration driven. It's extensible and scalable, and we have 100% coverage for all the enterprise integration patterns that we will also discuss in the future, right? The micro integrator, like I said, is a container friendly, more a profile that is more container friendly, but it is also, it has the same capabilities like the centralized bus enterprise service bus module. In terms of the things that it can do, it pretty much does the same thing. So the connectors that we have like more hundred, actually we have more than 200 connectors now in the store. Basically what they do is they do all the housekeeping activities for you. So if you are an integration developer, you can just concentrate on the integration logic than the housekeeping activities that you have to anyway deal with when you connect to these systems. Basically the connectors allow you to abstract that out and then concentrate on your work only. And then you can also build your own connectors if you wish. We have SDKs, and then you can use web APIs to do that. And then these can be shared across different teams as well, right? So I spoke a little bit about the enterprise integration patterns. If you are an integration developer, this is definitely something that is known to you. It is very popular. We have 100% coverage for all the published enterprise integration patterns out there, right? So if you go to this link, you can see how you can implement all of that using our products. Then, like I said, if you want to expose data services as a data as a service, that is also possible. We support exposing databases as well as spreadsheets as data sources out there, right? So another component that we have in Enterprise Integrator, especially for the container native and then the microservices deployments, is we have a component called the Streaming Integrator. This streaming integrator is actually a real-time streaming engine, which can once again connect to multiple systems, either for input as well as output. And using this streaming integrator, you can do transformations, enrichment, correlation of data and also aggregations, cleanse data and things like that. So this can also work hand in hand with the micro integrator. This once again has its own. So our enterprise integrator has a low code development model where you have a basically a UI. Now streaming integrator has its own IDE inbuilt where you can easily build a sequence like this. And then you can also get the code view of it if you want to, which is, you will see it's very much SQL-like. It uses a open source language called Siddhi, which is also developed by WSO2. It's very popular complex event processing and streaming SQL language. So you can use it in a basically low code fashion using either the drag and drop interface or the coding environment. And then we have the analytics for enterprise integrator as well, which gives you insights about how your integrations are eventually used. Now, talking a little bit about the low code integration, we have an IDE called the WSO2 Integration Studio, through which you will build most of the integrations. It has its own micro integrator runtime embedded so that you can deploy it then and there onto the IDE and test it out inside. Again, a low code experience where you can drag and drop and then create your integration sequence just like this. And then it also, so you can create all your sequences here just by dragging and dropping things from a tool palette. We call these mediators, like the building blocks that allows you to build the integration sequences. So once you do that, once you're very experienced with this, what you can also do is you can use the language that is behind that called Synapse language, which is the code view of what you're building on the other side. Basically, it's an XML-based DSL that whenever you drop a mediator from the tool palette, what happens is it actually converts it into this the right XML notation. But if you're well versed with this, we have IntelliSense support and context aware help here, auto completion and everything here as well that you can use for that purpose. Then we have a data mapper, a visual data mapper that you can use from on the IDE, where you can map let's say one schema to another. It could be XML to JSON or JSON to JSON or CSV, things like that. It supports multiple formats and it can do a whole bunch of different operations like you see here, arithmetic, string operations, type conversion, and things like that. So it can help you to do the data mapping visually, right? Then on the IDE itself, we can do basically the debugging itself. So you can set up breakpoints here, you can do all of that, and then debug your flow. And you can also see the messages that are flowing through flowing through the individual mediators that are there. So it allows you to debug this in a much better way, right? Then the IDE also has a unit testing framework where you can write unit tests against all the integrations that you do. It also allows you to mock the services, backend services out, so that you can actually test out your integrations without the real backend services there. Now this unit test that you write on the IDE will also be packaged when you deploy this. So you can also make this unit test part of your CI/CD process when you wanna test it out, right? And on the IDE itself, we have first class support for Docker and Kubernetes. So what we mean by that in the integration space is that from the IDE, you can, once you have done your integration sequences, you can expose or export the integration sequences that you've built into a deployable module that also contains the Docker and Kubernetes artifacts. So you can straight away with a simple kubectl command, you can deploy it directly onto the to a containerized deployment. Right, and Enterprise Integrator also has similar command line tools like API Manager for integration with CI/CD pipeline. So I'm not going to repeat that whole process again. Basically, just like the API control tool, you have tools here that you can easily integrate the whole thing into a pipeline. Right. And with that, we come to the end of Enterprise Integrator, and we are now running another poll. Right. Okay. So let's move on. So the last one is the identity server. So basically, identity server is a once again a custom identity and access management product that supports things like it's optimized for identity federation, single sign-on, adaptive and multi-factor authentication, and things like that. Right. So unlike other open core vendors, basically this has all the core components and another connector framework that allows you to do everything under the same license, right? There's nothing that comes separately, unlike some of the other products that are out there. So the identity server has different components here, you know, for self-service, for securing APIs, social logins, then doing federated identity, and then our identity federation and SSO. Then we have an analytics component. We have you know, adaptive authentication and so on. So bunch of features within the identity server. So let me give you a very brief idea of what we have. So the capabilities are identity federation and SSO, adaptive and multi-factor authentication. We can do identity provisioning and administration, also fine-grained authorization, API and microservices security, and we have some privacy related features as well, and then identity analytics, right? So let me give you a quick overview of these. Basically, identity federation and single sign-on, you can use, we support multiple protocols like SAML2, OpenID Connect, AWS Federation, and things like that, so that you can connect to multiple or different applications can use different protocols here. So we can federate into different applications using the protocols that they support. So you can use one product, but different protocols for the different applications that you want to integrate into in doing SSO and identity federation, right? And then as part of this, you can do like single sign-on, single logout across multiple protocols, do role and claim transformations as part of integration as well. Then the identity server also can act as a bridge between two different identity or provisioning protocols. For example, if you want to authenticate users on one application with another, but these two applications are using completely two different identity standards, the identity server can do the protocol transformation and bridging for you, right? And so in this scenario, you can see Salesforce on one side, Microsoft AD on the other side. So Salesforce connection is using SAML2. The other side is using AWS Federation, right? So basically, the identity server will do the required transformation from SAML2 to AWS Federation here when it's required, right, to get the integration going. Then for accounts and credential management, we support having basically multiple user stores here as well, right? And also we support self-registration, password recovery reset, and update user profiles and all that to using a user self-care portal. And then these things can also be configured to go through different approval workflows, right? So let's say, for example, the user signs up on self-service, but straight away their account is not created. It can generate a trigger for somebody to approve it, and only when they are approved, the actual account is created. So things like that, you can customize using workflows on this, right? But basically, you can have multiple user stores connected to the identity server. And for various reasons, for security reasons, you might have user stores or separated out user stores, let's say for external and internal users and things like that, right? So you can have something like that set up as well. Then identity provisioning, we support SCIM standard as well as SPML and a bunch of other for inbound as well as outbound provisioning. So what you can do here is you can create users either as a batch using some of these protocols, or you can do just-in-time provisioning. When the user logs in, for example, to a one system, you can create the account on another system just in time whenever it's done, right? So this is also can be configured on the identity server. Right, then we have also strong and adaptive authentication. So we can do multi-step, multi-option. So as in, you can configure it to have any number of steps. You can configure it to have any number of authenticators to do it. And you can even do adaptive authentication. What we mean by adaptive authentication is you basically come up, you script your business logic in some way, and then wire up the authentications based on certain business logic as you wish. Like, for example, if you're in a bank and you want to authenticate the transaction user who's doing the transaction, if the amount that is transferred is less than a certain amount, you can force only two factors. If it is more than a certain amount, you can force another factor. If it is beyond a certain other amount, you can select which third factor you want to use, for example, right? So like that, you can script it based on the business scenario as well. Then we also have local and federated authentication, basically either using basic auth or using some other mechanisms like using the authenticators, like either using passwords, ping, challenge questions, or using two-factor authentication using SMS OTP, FIDO, and other different mechanisms, or using inheritance based, right? Whether you can use Veridium or MePIN or any other provider for that as well. Then we also support federated authentication using SAML2 and OIDC and things like that. Now, how we do all of this is basically, once again, through a whole bunch of authenticators and connectors that are available for the identity server as well. Just like the connectors for EI, these are available to you at no additional cost. You can download, install, and start using them, right? So these are all part of the product offering that we have. So we have all more than, I think, probably more than 50 connectors now for identity server, right? And then they can be categorized very broadly into these social login connectors, SaaS, IDaaS, security as a service connectors, outbound provisioning. So we have connectors for hardware, software authentication, two-factor authentication, mobile biometrics, all like that. And we keep on adding more and more connectors to both the enterprise integrator connectors, identity server connectors, and also the streaming analytics engine also has its own set of connectors that we keep on adding to, right? So then I mentioned about the adaptive authentication. So as a developer, this is some cool feature that you can use to script out the business logic as you wish. So there's two ways that you can do this. One is on the identity server itself, there is a JavaScript based interface like that, where you can easily use to code everything in. On the right hand side, you see the templates, standard templates that you use. If you drag and drop one of those or add one of those, you can just modify, and it comes with everything configured for you. You just have to go and modify the relevant things for you and start using it. Or you can write anything on your own. If you want to do something even more complex than this, what is available as templates here or whatever, then you can use the streaming engine for that. So what you saw earlier as the streaming analytics engine or the streaming integrator, it can also be used here, where you go and construct a sequence there, and you can use it. Now, one example where you can use something like that is if you want to do something like risk-based authentication, right? What you do is, from the identity server, you can basically feed the streaming engine with login patterns, last successful login time, like their typing speed and consecutive incorrect password attempts and everything. You can feed all of this information into the streaming engine, let it run its magic, and then the identity server can get a risk score from the streaming engine. And then based on the risk score, you can force an authentication step or whatever you like after that, right? So there's an advanced option here where you can go and write your code on the streaming engine and then integrate with the identity server as well. And then there's a whole bunch of portals that you can also use.
We did a quick time check. We have just over 10 minutes to go, so we have another speaker. So
yeah, so I'm almost done with it, Nishan, right? So there's only a few more slides to go, right? So I'll finish this section and then we can continue. So basically the self-care portal and recovery portal and the registration portal all are themable as you wish, and you can change it as you wish. The user portal is completely React.js based. Login and registration portal, recovery portal are JSP and servlets, but they will also be done in React sometime soon. How this will look at is, so if you want to log in, if you want to theme your login portals, it could be something like this, right? You can have it you know, themed any way you like. And then basically the product also supports role-based access control and attribute-based access control through SACML. And then we have also a SACML tryout tool within the product that you can, when you write the SACML logic, you can test it out with this, right? And then the last two features here is basically how you secure APIs and microservices. Now, if you look at this slide, these are the features that are pretty much available on, most of these are available on the API manager as well, because the API manager key manager is a cut down or a stripped down version of the identity server, the one that we ship out of the box. So so basically SAML, JWT, grant types, and all of those are supported, you know, a larger superset of features are supported on the identity server than what you get on the key manager by default. Then we also have a bunch of privacy related features here. You can use the user consent management here. We have a you know, to record the consent management and things like that when you single sign on and do all of that. We have a privacy toolkit that allows you to remove any references to user identities and things like that, anonymize the data and all that. We have complete support for GDPR regulations in Europe and things like that as a result, right? And then just like all the other products, we have identity analytics also, where you can get to know how many, you know, certain stats about logins and suspicious login attempts and all that can be converted into alerts. You can monitor the long sessions and things like that using this, right? And with that, we come to the last poll. So you will see the last poll on your screen. Right, so with that, I just want to summarize everything that I've shown you in the presentation. Basically, WSO2 has an open source API-led integration platform. We've got a whole bunch of free self-paced training material, certification programs for any developers who are interested in using our products. We have a whole bunch of developer-friendly features that I've shown you in the presentation: React.js based UIs, the low code integration options, the IDEs with context sensitive help and debugging and unit testing and everything, then the support for Docker and Kubernetes container based deployments, command line tools that you can use for CI/CD pipelines, then try it out features and all that, but then the connectors and all that. But one additional thing that I want to say to you before I close: all WSO2 products are also developed API first. So everything that you do through a UI with WSO2 products, you can also, there is an API behind the scenes that you can also use. So additional to the command line tools and everything, you can also use the admin APIs to do a lot of things behind the scenes as well. That can also be another option for your CI/CD pipelines. And with that, I conclude my bit of the presentation, and I'll hand it over to NN for the rest of the presentation. Thank you.
Hey, thanks, sir. Thanks, Bidra. So, Bidra, can you just give me the presenter more, Bidra?
Yes, and then just give me a second. I'm just sharing it with you right now.
Yeah. All right, so guys, are you able to see my screen? Let me present it.
Yeah, go ahead, Anand.
Okay. Thanks. Hey, thanks, Vedra. So you have pretty much covered, actually, there are a lot of, detailed information about all three products. It's good, it's really helpful for everyone to understand that. So, okay, once again, I'm welcome, everyone. Okay, I know that today is a festival day, so a lot of people, spending their time to understand and joining this, meetup to gain more knowledge about the product and the project features about WSO2 and other things. Next, quickly, 15 to 20 minutes, in the interest of time, I will try to cover as much as possible to see our LTI is joining with WSO2, right? So how we started the journey, what are the things we are doing in LTI with respect to WSO2, product and enhancements and accelerator and other stuff, and what are our offerings as well, and where and all we have implemented in them at the very large scale, how the WSO2 product helps us to meet the customer requirement as well. Thanks again. Let me jump to that. Okay, our 360 view of relationships, right? So with LTI and WSO2, so there's a holistic view of the complete thing, right? Exactly, the starting from our partnership. We say that we have a premier integration partner and the reseller partner with WSO2, and soon we are moving to the upper ladder to the one of the the topmost partner in the future very quickly. So the partnership helped us with get all the benefits whatever WSO2 is offering, at the same time we were also able to go to the market and say, hey, this is what our relationship with the WSO2, what are the offerings we have, and jointly how we can build the competency. And then the next one, if you talk about the certification, the partnership helped us to create this create the pool, right? The competency, create the skill sets within our LTI to offer the complete lot of the architect certification and the developer certification to most of the people, right? From within LTI, almost 70% above all certified resource in WSO2. The next level of the $1 million deals, the WSO2, and as well as that are LTI is going market together, so go to market. Our go-to-market strategy to get more deals, right? So most of the things are $1 million deals. How we are go and pursue there in the and different geographies. Right? The fourth one I guess talk about. This is a quite interesting thing. We have invested from LTI side. We have created a API zone within LTI. So that API with the API zone, we are investing to do that R&Ds and come up with a marketplace and open banking architecture, that complete APIfication, right? The complete APIfications we are growing, and we can say that incubate this API related activities within our practice. This is one of the unique features, is one of the unique initiatives we have started in last year. We have inaugurated the API zone in LTI. The next one we can talk about, it's not just only with APAC region or within India. So we have footprints across the globe. So for Middle East, North America, and Europe. So most of the customers we have in Nordic regions as well. So with respect to WSO2, I'm not talking about overall LTI per se. I'm talking about in WSO2, what are the projects and what are the tech innovation things and what are the about it is the accelerator and other stuff which we are building using our WSO2 products. The last one is our the sixth one is our accelerators and frameworks and tools. Already we have something called many two WSO2 products which you have to migrate from your applications from one platform or one technology to the MuleSoft, the WSO2 or MuleSoft to WSO2 or from web methods to WSO2, TIBCO to WSO2, IBM to WSO2. So the different marketplaces, market, different people are playing the major role with respect to API and integration area. So if you wanted to migrate from your application from one technology to WSO2, we have the acceleration tools and everything. The other one we can talk about, we have announced framework called microservice-based integration framework. Right, so this gives us a platform if we want to create a microservices implementation using WSO2, how quickly we can go and build the platform for our customer. That's another interesting role. The third one, which I know it's very, the recently we from LTI side and LTI and WSO2 worked together and came up with a connectors and one of the Documentum connectors. And you know there are other connectors also in pipeline. So we are building a connectors for WSO2 as well, and it will be published soon in that WSO2 marketplace. The last one you can see that you know we have from LTI side as well as in WSO2 side, we have CXO level connects quite often and think about our strategies, how we can go and you know reach to the customer and talk to our you know capabilities and the product capabilities from the LTI side as well as the WSO2 side on our accelerators. We will go and pitch in and get more you know business growth, you know, in WSO2. So overall, this is the complete 360 degree, you know, our relationship with the WSO2. What are the activities we are doing? What are the deals we are going to get in? How we are going to build the competency is a complete view of our capabilities in WSO2. And this is again, there's a huge investment. L&D is, you know, we got an you know, approval from our management to say that, hey, this is the platform where we can go and build the our gap, you know, skill sets. All right. So let me move to the next interesting thing. The next one is like our unique offer in LTI. This is called Smart Integration Assistance. This is I can say that it's a full-fledged end-to-end. It's starting from the assessment phase of you know any product or the technology to post-production. Right? There are four major you know phases you will go through for any kind of you know, integration API. Related projects. Right? These are the four major phases everyone will go through. Each and every phases, we have a unique, you know, accelerator, developers, and a framework. Even the consulting phase also get involved in all these three, four phases. Right? If you say smart assessment assistance, where you know we have a you know framework, technologies, and as well as the combination of our utilities, which will help the customer to identify the right set of implementation and the right set of product identification and you know right set of you know how they can modernize their techno applications all you know related to get the right fit of products. Then when they move to the next level, when they move to the design phase, we have a lot of you know design patterns, and that will go such as the business user as well as the IT you know people come and say that for your requirement, what kind of the pattern will suit for you. Whether it's you know you have to go for complete API manager, or you have to go with your you know integration where you need integration, where you need identity manager, or where you need to you know go for an BPM product. So it will give us the complete integration and the patterns and the framework accelerators, as well as they can identify from their enterprise architect level what kind of the integration and architecture mechanisms right they have to follow. And if it is already there, those kind of implementation, our tool will suggest them that hey, you have already implemented this kind of integration patterns. Why can't you reuse it? Why can't you tailor it? And again, it will go for your again the approval process to you know if it is a new, then it will go for the approval process. Then it will be archived in your repositories. And then it, when you go to the development, as I mentioned in my previous slide, you will have any two WSO2. And you have microservice based platform, how you can quickly build and you know accelerate your implementation. Once you developed and then you have moved your code to the productions, now what next? Yeah. So now you have to track and monitor your system, end to end system. Right? I'm not talking about only your integration product. I'm not talking only about your API products. You have to talk, you have to monitor your transaction from start to end, right? End to end transaction, how I can monitor, how I can see that where my transaction is failing, why it's failing it. So what is the you know, trend, you know, what is the pattern? So it would help, you know, us to identify where I can go quickly, go and fix it. And certain areas, right? It's intelligent enough, you know, auto healing also is possible there. And, you know, it will go and automatically heal your issues over there. So this complete, this package, right? When you call it Smart Integration Assistant, it's in a complete package. This package is a unique idea and one of our offering from LTI. It has been, we have filed this patent and it is still in the state, it's still, pending state, but yes, we have filed that. It's a unique offering from LTI. It's definitely help our customer to achieve their, efficiency and scale their implementation process. Yeah. Now you know that our investment, and you know that what is our relationship with the customer, right? Now the next, quickly I can move that where we have implemented the large scale implementation for our customer using our WSO2 product. The first one is, right, the customer is worldwide. They have their presence, but predominantly, right, their main business is there in Swedish. It's an automobile manufacturer, mainly on heavy engine vehicle. They are going to, they are manufacturing it. This is the customer. They come and told us, hey, look at yours. So I have my this. I have a lot of my applications, point to point, and it's a traditional way of that. Over the period, we keep adding different technologies. Too much of technologies we have, but we don't know. We need to have one platform. So since that many applications, where I can go and create one platform which would be helpful for us to manage and control all my transactions, right? Then integration transaction. So they wanted to move from their traditional application centric integration to our modernizing their application. So then we suggested them, hey, look at here, the WSO2 would be the right product for you. This product will help you to create your one platform, one centric applications where you can come and create a marketplace, API marketplace, so that quickly you can go and consume your APIs and you can go and update your APIs, and then easily you can go to the production, and any changes in productions, if you want to do any enhancement, it's easy, it's very quickly you can go and modify your existing systems as well, and it will give you that holistic one place, one platform can control all your application and transactions. And after we implemented, we come to know that almost 100 plus APIs, in the production right now, and more than 350 people been trained in API, because it's very easy for them to use their APIs and consume their APIs, even in dynamically they can create it. And another unique thing is, since we already mentioned, right, already this customer has a lot of products and technologies in their in-house system, right, in their on-prem. So now we are moving to the cloud. So initially it's not easy for them to completely lift and shift everything to the cloud. So then we propose them that we can start with your hybrid integration. So your latest and technologies can be there in your cloud. Your legacy application can be remain there in your on-prem. So we propose our hybrid integration platform. So that they came up, see that the real benefit of implementing API manager movement. So now you can see that, as Vedra rightly mentioned, that this WSO2, this integration products, right, we are not only for one particular verticals and not only one particular business units, right? We can use these products for multiple business units, the multiple verticals, right? So let me go to another completely different vertical where we have implemented that WSO. These are larger deals, right? There's another one is in NADEC. There is a digital payment service provider. So one of our digital payment service provider, he came and said, hey, look at here. So I want to control my real-time connectivity with my payment system with different gateways. Say, I have MasterCard, people using Visa card. So how can I connect all these things in the real-time? How I can be added into the banking systems? And people nowadays using your Digi Wallet, Google Pay, Apple Pay, and other stuff as well. So how I can manage all those things? So, and the third thing is, they came and asked us, I wanted to control my complete lifecycle management of my payment service. So starting from the customer to issuing the card, and then once they started using it, integrating with multiple DigiLocker wallet providers and integrate with their banking system. So then again, even here also, you know, we proposed our WSO2 API manager. The WSO2 API manager is create a lot of API. Can you say that the marketplace for them as well? And they were able to quickly go in real time. They can control each and every transaction. And even if they wanted to add more functionalities or a feature to that, easily they were able to go and tailor those all these APIs and able to move into the production. This is a, again, this is a pure play cloud-based application because customer wanted to move, they want to do in the when we started a couple of years ago, then everyone is moving towards their digitization. So they want to move everything into the cloud. It's a complete cloud platform. So the other thing is we use a container-based architecture over here to, for a data security or scalability and for, you know, the regulation, right? So since it's a payment gateway, there are a lot of compliances are there regularly, you know, we have to meet the compliances. So one of them are, you know, one of them is PCI DSS is the mandatory compliance they have to move. So this is another customer where we have implemented the WSO2. It's in a large implementation, right? It's 100% PCI compliance. We are able to complete it. These two are the major ones. So I had to just give the highlight of where we have implemented our WSO2. With that, I'm going to close my my conversation here. And next we can go for Q&A. Hope you will understand the product. Hope you will understand all the features available within this product. And you know our capability, even LTA capability, and our journey. WSO2, it's a long journey. We are looking forward to work together and to build a lot of solutions, industry-based solutions, which can meet the vertical needs and other steps as well. Thanks a lot, guys. Now we can go for a few Q&A. I know that's already late. Sorry for that. So we planned for only 1.5 hours. Now it's dragged another 15 minutes more. Nishant, over to you. Thanks a lot, guys.
Yeah. Thank you, Vidura and Anand, for this insightful session. I would like to thank all the participants for being here, hanging in there, even though the session has gone well past the 90-minute mark. The link to the recording of this session will be sent to all the attendees, along with a copy of the presentation in the next couple of days. One more thing, in order to help us continue to make the WSO2 meetups better, because this is going to be one of the many meetups that we would be organizing in the future, and that would help you in getting more detailed insights about the WSO2 product stack. So do please provide us with a feedback of this webinar by filling out a quick survey, which would pop up right after the session ends. And as I had mentioned earlier, attendees will be getting the promo codes that can be used to avail WSO2 product certifications free of cost. With that being said, I would like to thank NN and Vidura once again. And I would like to thank all the participants for joining us today, and we will see you next time. Thank you all.
Sorry, Nishant, I see two hands raised on the attendees list. I'm not sure whether we have any other questions that they want to raise. If they have questions, I'm more than happy to answer though.
Yeah, you can go ahead, Vidura, or we can probably we can answer the questions offline and send it out to the attendees.
So I have answered pretty much all the questions that were posted on the questions tab. So there's Krishna Dasari and Tanu Saraswat who's having their hands up. I just want to check with them whether they have any questions. If so, if you can post the questions on the questions list, I can answer them right away. I can also unmute them if they want to ask the questions right away as well. So I'll unmute Krishna first. Hello, Krishna, can you hear me?
Yes, sir. Yeah.
Right. Okay. If you have a question, you can ask. Yes.
So I'm completely new to WSO2 and web services. I basically worked on Oracle application side. So in a layman term, I just wanted to know initially what is the purpose of this WSO2 and where we use it. But after going through the session, I just came to know like where we use WSO2 and else. That's it.
Sure. Yeah, so we are a middleware platform, right? So we've been in this middleware business for a long time now. So our platform is basically an integration platform, as you know already. So as long as we've answered your questions, I'm happy. All good.
Yeah, thank you.
I'm then unmuting Tanu. Tanu, can you hear us? Okay, looks like there's an issue with the now. So let me. I am unmuting Krishna Dasari. Or did we just talk to you, Krishna?
Hello. Yeah. We just talked, right?
Okay. Sorry. I'll lower your hand so that I know we've spoken to you. Right. Good. Okay. Then I'm unmuting Rahul Thoma.
So hi Vidura.
Hi, Rahul.
So I just have one question. Since it is a middleware platform, probably if I missed it, please, my apologies. Does it have a connectors available for IBM MQ platform?
Yes, we have. If you have a look at store.wsu2.com, you can just straight away go to store.wsu2.com.
Okay.
You will see the connector store there. For IBM MQ, I think we can just simply connect with JMS as well. Yeah. So
okay.
we can use the standard JMS transport there as well for that.
Okay. Chick. And it supports both SIML and JWT.
Yes. Yeah. For two different reasons though, right? So SAML is basically for identity federation and all of that. JWT we use for propagation. So we use JWT for multiple things. We use it for propagation of user attributes from the gateway to the backend services. We can use it for that. We can also use it as a signed JWT token where, so basically how the self, I mentioned briefly that you can use the, you can scale the gateways without the key managers that we achieve through JWTs as well. So in OAuth2 mode you can use the OAuth2 OPAC tokens with our product as well as use a signed JWT. The signed JWT is like a self-contained JWT token which is signed by the using the public key of the trusted STS, right? And then the gateway can decrypt it using the public key. The keys, the JWT is signed by the STS using its private key. So because of that, there's a trust relationship that is maintained.
Okay. Thank you. That answers. Thank you.
I just unmuted Roika.
Yeah. Hi, Vidura. Thank you for the session. So I'm quite relatively new to WSO2 and I primarily work with Software AZ and MuleSoft. So one question I have related to the licensing model. So what I could understand from the presentation that all the connectors are free for enterprise use. Is that a correct understanding?
That's correct, yes.
Okay, so what kind of licensing model do you follow? Like for enterprise use, it's completely open source?
So it's like this. So this open source version of it is, so the difference primarily between open source and our licensing model is you buy a subscription from us, right? Mm-hmm. Can you hear me right?
Yes, I can hear you.
Right. So you basically buy a subscription from us. That subscription entitles you. So the subscription is usually based on a core model, right? We have we have different models, but for simplicity's sake, let's say it's a core model. Mm-hmm. So you can buy, let's say, a number of cores from us, and it is up to mm-hmm. you how you, what products you use on those cores. It's completely up to you, right?
Okay.
Now, We can give you recommendations on based on your use cases and things like that, how many cores you might need for API Manager, your instances, mm-hmm. and so on, but that's a different thing. Mm-hmm. What the subscription model essentially gets you is reactive and proactive support for okay. any of the incidents and queries that you might have. Now, what I mean by that is when you use our products, you get the enterprise version, you get updates pushed to you through a tool yeah. called WSO2 Update Manager on a daily basis, right?
Yeah. On
a daily basis, we release updates. You can decide how frequently you want to receive the updates. And yes. then, so what we mean by proactive and reactive, if I quickly tell you the difference, proactive mm-hmm. means if we find something on our side as a bug or yeah. whatever the testing we do, we immediately ship that to all our subscription users straight away, irrespective mm-hmm. of the version they are using, as long as it's a supported version, right?
Okay.
So let's say you are using API Manager 3.1.0 and somebody else reports a bug, right? So mm-hmm. the moment we fix that bug for that customer, we also roll out that same fix to all the API Manager 3.1.0 subscription customers.
Okay.
Right? Mm-hmm. So that's the proactive fixes. Reactive fixes are when you come across some issue, we give a fix to you for that issue that you encountered straight away as well. And both of these are, so obviously reactive fixes are having very strict SLAs on our side, like how quickly we react to it and how quickly we fix it. Mm-hmm. Right? So those are the two things that you get, but also as part of the subscription, you get a whole bunch of other deployment artifacts and things like that are not available to, you know, our open source users, right? So mm-hmm. for multiple platforms, you will get deployment artifacts. For all our deployment patterns, you will get deployment artifacts. And if you are a subscription user, we might even customize it for you to a certain extent if you want to.
Okay.
And you have a dedicated account team that you can talk to all the time, a salesperson as well as a solutions architect, which you can send, you know, any questions anytime. So like that, there are a whole yeah. bunch of other advantages on the subscription.
Okay, so it's basically based on the course, number of course that will be providing. So it's not on the component wise that API Manager is licensed separately. So it's not like that.
It can be like that too, but essentially okay. it comes down to the number of cores API Manager users.
Yeah, right? Got it.
And for the micro components like the micro gateway, micro integrator, we also have a volumetric pricing model as well. So based mm-hmm. There are usage tiers and the number of transactions. So based on that, we price it differently as well.
Okay. Yeah, thank you. Yeah, got it.
I just unmuted Kumar, Gaurav Kumar.
Hello.
Hi, Kumar.
Hi, Vidura. So thanks a lot for the wonderful presentation. First, I would like to thanks to both of you. And secondly, I am from an Oracle middleware background where I have worked on Oracle Server Suite. And in addition, I have also worked on Red Hat Fuse for the integration perspective. So I sure. just want to understand, since my journey has become from a developer to a associate architect level, so how can I quickly map my roles and responsibilities as a WSO2 professional? This is the first question. And the second question is, if I'm targeting towards the API manager and a WSO2 integrator, so what essential development skills that I would require so that I can quickly groom up myself and my team as well?
Right. So if you have worked with any other ESB product or integration product, obviously that skill set is transferable to a certain extent. Although the way that you do things on our platform might be different to what you're doing on Oracle, you can still conceptually visualize how you would sort of dissect an integration problem and then how you built on it, right? So I think that the immediate thing that you will understand is, so the first thing that I'll get you to do is go through our self-paced training. It's all free. It is all instructor-led and all of that. There's lab sessions and everything also on that you can use and do. Okay. So once you go through the self-paced training, you should have a good understanding of, say, how to create an API, what are the features, how do you define policies, how you apply them, the integration sequences, how to build them, so on and so forth, right? And then if you're from an Oracle background, basically you have to just map out how some, like, you have to have an understanding of how the media, different mediators work, right? So we have a whole bunch of mediators that you can string together and then build a sequence, and technically how you, what mediator to use at what time is the only thing that you need to know, right? So we have mediators to set properties, mediators to create payloads, mediators to do you know, scatter back, gather patterns sort of thing. So all of that, right? So that is the granular level knowledge that you can get. Then if you're familiar with things like the enterprise integration patterns, if you look at the documentation that is related to that, you will easily, you'll be able to easily map how you would implement that you have is somewhat transferable here, because the difference is going to be just the building blocks, right? With that, so if I use a toy analogy here, basically if you had right, if you had 4x4 pieces there, now you might have one here, 2x1 pieces, and you know, 2x2 pieces here, so you can put together the same thing in a different way here, right? So similarly, you can do the same, I believe, here. And then to upskill yourself and the team, I would say self-paced training first, and then you do the certification programs that we have for developers, administrators, and then solutions architects. We have all three certification levels there.
Okay, just one last question from my side. Recently, sure. I have been engaged with the implementation of WSO2 API Manager, where I have done the installation in a high availability mode and used a custom specific database MySQL for this product. Mm-hmm. Still, each and everything I'm using, it's free. So I'm not able to identify how this tracking can be done, or if some customer is using WSO2. So when and what time I need a support, actually. Recently, I have done the implementation for a small customer for a POC perspective. It is running from last couple of months, but I didn't get any notification or the violation of the policies or anything else, so that I can be alerted that I need to buy a subscription for the same, or I can use it free.
Yeah, we don't have something like that. We allow you to use the product free. That's not an issue, right? So if you are running the deployment, so if you are running the open source version of your deployment, open source version of the product in production, you are definitely taking a risk, because that is not supported, right? Right. So you have to have a way of supporting. So it's like this, right? So the difference between the support, the subscription versus the open source version is, subscription, if you're on a subscription, anything that you encounter will be fixed by us through an SLA that we give you, right? Adhering to that SLA. Anything that others find or we find, we will fix it and ship it to you straight up. And you have a lot more
active and reactive approach, which you have discussed.
Correct. And you get a lot more other value, like different artifacts and help and all that from us, right? As part of the subscription. Now you might, for whatever reason, this is obviously unintentional, there can be a security issue, security bug that we didn't know when we released API Manager 3.1.0, right? Mm-hmm. Let's say after 2 months we find it, we fix it, and we send that fix to all the subscription customers. Now if you're running API Manager 3.1.0 from as we released it on, like, let's say a one quarter back or last year, right? Mm-hmm. You might still have that security issue in your deployment, and you're running it in production now. Right. So the only way that you can get the fix for that is either that you download the code, build it yourself, you know, extract the code and, you know, apply it by yourself, or you have to wait until the major release comes out next time, because that major release will have all the fixes that we've done in the interim also going out in the open source version. Right. So you are taking a risk by running the open source version in production. Mm-hmm. If the system is mission critical, my suggestion is that you get at least a basic subscription, right, to cover all of that, right? And that is the help you get. And even from a cost perspective, we are a lot more cheaper than our competitors, right? You will see that if you compare the pricing.
Sure. Thanks a lot.
No worries. I am unmuting Tanu again. Can you hear Tanu this time? Looks like there's still a issue with. Okay, I think we'll what we'll do is we have a whole bunch of questions more on the questions window. So if we haven't answered anything already, we will somehow provide these answers offline to all of you, whoever who asked it. And then I think because we've gone out of the scheduled time, we'll end the meetup now. And you will all get, like Nishant mentioned, all the slide decks, the slides and everything after this. Nishant, Sandy, and then shall we conclude the meetup then? And then
yes,
we can ask outstanding questions offline.
Correct. So as I mentioned, we'll address the outstanding questions offline, along with the link and the recording of the session and the copy of the presentation that we'll be sending to the attendees within the next couple of days.
Yeah. So Nishant, very quickly, can I answer one more question? Because I think I can easily answer it. There's a question about support, how we support 24/7, whether it will be on per call basis and all that. No, it's like I said, it's just a subscription, and you get a number of incidents. There's unlimited incidents on that subscription. You can raise query hours. The query hours that you get are for you to ask questions if you're doing any development, and that is proportional to the subscription amount you pay. And there's no limit as such on the incidents, but there can be a limit on the query hours you get. And then we do support SOAP to REST APIs as well. I'm just answering a question by Gurbachan, right? With that, I think we can conclude, and then the rest of the questions I'll take it offline and provide answers.
Okay, Vidura. Thank you everyone once again, and thank you Vidura, thank you NN for this insightful and interactive session. Have a great day everyone, and for the Indian audience, happy Ganesh Chaturthi as well.
Thank you. Cheers.
Thank you.